think we're going to go ahead and get started. There's plenty of sandwiches and refreshments on the table, and we are so glad to have you all here on this very, very cold night. Our hostess this evening is actually Lou Ann Zajac. Lou Ann runs the country store for the San Jacinto Chapter Daughters of the Republic of Texas, and she asked me if she could make a very quick announcement. So,
very quick. Our San Jacinto Chapter Daughters of the Republic of Texas is offering four $5,000 scholarships to Houston area seniors. And if you're interested, if you will go to our website, you can get my email and then I can send it out. So
that's it. Thank you. Yes, thank you. No, that is wonderful. So I hope some of you that are teachers will go to the website and remember, because this is that's a wonderful and very generous thing for the San Jacinto Chapter to do. And some of you who have been here and met with us in the summertime know how terribly warm this place can be. It's kind of cozy tonight, and I know the ladies have recently had a lot of repairs on this log house. It actually dates from 1936. It was built as a celebration of the Texas Centennial. And the idea was that this was going to be a place where they could host the dignitaries as they came to Houston. And as the name applies, it is San Jacinto Chapter of the Daughters of the Republic of Texas. The Daughters of the Republic of Texas were actually founded in Houston, Texas. And the San Jacinto Chapter, their whole, I guess you could say, mission and purpose was saving the San Jacinto battleground. And I love to tell the story that when it came to actually closing on the original tract that the state bought, which was around 320 some odd acres, the mighty state of Texas had to turn to these ladies in 1901 to borrow $400 to consummate the purchase of the San Jacinto battleground, or the original 300 and some odd acres that now is part of 1,100 acres that is the San Jacinto Battleground State Historic Site. So from time to time we talk about historic preservation, the women of Texas have had a big part in not only the Alamo, and a lot of you know the story about Clara Driscoll, but also in our own San Jacinto Battleground. I'm Jan DeVault. I'm the president of the San Jacinto Battleground Conservancy, and we are a small 501c3, and our goal and purpose is to protect and reclaim, if you will, as much of the battleground as possible, and also do educational programs, which this is what we're doing this evening. I also just want to take a minute and introduce Barbara Eves, Dave Britton, here, Dave Singleton, Joe Nelson, who is here, Joe Francis Greenlaw, who are, and I don't know, I don't think we have any of our other directors, but they are the intrepid directors and volunteer staff of our organization. And sitting at the money changing table is Mark Connell. Mark, stick your hand up. Mark is our history intern. There is hope. Mark is from the University of Houston Public History Department, and we have him for an entire semester. He's working on his master's degree, and we have tasked him with various things, one of which is actually building a land abstract, or an abstract, if you will, for property that we bought in 2010 that was original to the San Jacinto Battleground. So, Mark, thank you for your interest in history. You renew our faith in another generation, so this is terrific. You all are here tonight to hear Dr. Carolina Castillo-Prim, and she needs probably very little introduction. Dr. Prim, if you had been my teacher and back in whenever I was taking Texas history, I would not have spent so many years pointlessly aiming myself in a lot of different directions. She is an enthusiastic teacher. She is an author. She is one of the best ambassadors that Texas history has ever had. And I think she knows many of you, and if there is ever anyone who we need to support, and can I tell? Okay. Dr. Krim could be, and we've got to figure out a way how to campaign. But she has been proposed as the state historian for, I guess it would be the beginning 2015.
No, this year and next year.
2014. So if you all would like to write a letter, that would be it would be to the office of the governor. That would be a great thing. It really would. She would be a wonderful spokesperson for Texas history. So I would like to welcome you here. Thank you so much for coming from Huntsville to visit with us today, and we look forward to what you were going to be talking about.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be with people who love history. That's one of the things that I truly, truly enjoy, is to get to share more history with those of you that already know so much. And that's the tremendous opportunity for me to be able to learn from you as well. I see we have some of our Granaderos de Galvez here, and I do want to mention just in passing, just briefly, I'm going to drop you back 100 years before we get started and mention a project that we have going on at the present time. I sort of feel like Bernardo de Galvez has sort of jerked me up by the ear and now is shaking me and making me do things that I didn't know I was going to have to do. Bernardo de Galvez, for those of you that are not familiar with him, you have heard of Galveston. Well, there you go. Now you've heard of Bernardo de Galvez. Actually, I was in Malaga and had a chance to meet Manolo Olmedo Checa, who is the vice president of the Association of Bernardo de Galvez. Manolo Olmedo Checa literally corralled me and said, I have found a document from the Continental Congress of 1783. And in that document, the Continental Congress agreed to hang the portrait of Bernardo de Galvez, governor of Louisiana and later viceroy of Mexico, of New Spain, in the halls of Congress. And I said, why? What's the reason? And he said, Bernardo de Galvez saved the American Revolution. And this is something that is a little known fact. This is something that is historically, we have overlooked it in many of the historical, I see your puzzled expression. Absolutely. Bernardo de Galvez was made governor of Louisiana in 1777, months after the American Revolution had been declared. Spain was not going to declare war against Britain. The French had. The French declared war against Great Britain and were happy to help the Americans. The Spanish, however, did not. But Bernardo de Galvez, with the help of Oliver Pollock, an Irish-American revolutionary and representative for Virginia, Oliver Pollock, with the help of Bernardo de Galvez, with funding from Bernardo de Galvez, he moved supplies up the Mississippi in great, big, huge 10-ton bateau barges. They had to row them up the Mississippi. They didn't have steamboats back then. So they rowed them up the Mississippi and got them all the way up to St. Louis. And from St. Louis, George Rogers Clark, General George Rogers Clark was able to use those supplies to defeat the British at Kaskaskia in Illinois. He was able to defeat the British all the way north to the Canadian border. George Rogers Clark also moved the materials to Washington. Washington had blankets because of Bernardo de Galvez and Oliver Pollock. Oliver Pollock used his own money, and when he ran out, he went to Governor Bernardo de Galvez and said, "I need more money," and Galvez gave it to him. Galvez, in the face of this blatant illegality, Bernardo de Galvez, when the British came knocking on his door and said, "Are you supplying the American rebels with supplies?" He said, "Who, me? Surely not. I don't know anything about Oliver Pollock." And literally, he talked the British out of attacking New Orleans. Bernardo de Galvez wrote to his small town of Malaga, and he said, "We need more money for the American Revolution." And the people of Malaga took 400,000 reales and sent that money to Bernardo de Galvez to help pay for supplies for the American Revolution. And you know what that money went for? It went to the French to pay for their naval forces to surround Yorktown. It was the Spanish, not the French, who made the difference in the American Revolution. So by 1779, finally, Spain declares war against the British, joins the Americans, and finally Bernardo is free to actually begin to attack the British forts. Now remember, after the French and Indian War, the British had taken all of West Florida all the way to the Mississippi. They controlled Baton Rouge. They controlled Manchac. They controlled Mobile and Pensacola. And so the British literally had a lock on the central part of the Gulf. And Bernardo de Galvez went to his advisors in New Orleans, and he said, "What should we do?" And they said, "We better get out of here. The British are going to attack. New Orleans can't be defended. We need to escape to Mexico as soon as possible." Bernardo de Galvez gathered his soldiers. He gathered militia. He gathered Indians. He gathered anybody, and Germans from Germantown, Acadians from the Acadian settlements. He got all of these people together. And in the face of a hurricane, he marched north and captured Baton Rouge, captured Manchac, captured all of the British defenses at Natchez, and literally ran the British out of the Mississippi. The next year, in 1780, he took his forces, made up of anybody and everybody he could get, and he attacked Mobile and defeated the British at Mobile. The next year, he had gone to Cuba and he asked for help from the governor of Cuba. And the governor of Cuba said, "Oh, no, no, no. You know, my God, if the British attack Havana and we don't have troops here to defend ourselves, we can't send you anybody. We can't send you anything." And he said, "Yes, you will." And sure enough, his uncle, Jose de Galvez, who was second only to the king in Spain, Jose de Galvez authorizes a fleet to come to help Bernardo de Galvez. The only problem was the admiral in charge of the fleet looks at the harbor of Pensacola, which is U-shaped and has a little island right in the center. And the British had put gun emplacements all around. And there was no way a ship could sail into that harbor without undergoing an attack by the British cannons. And the admiral tried you know, his ship was too big and it got stuck on the sandy bottom, and he said, oh, no, I can't. And Bernardo de Galvez took a cannon ball from the ones the British had been firing, and he sent the cannonball to the admiral, and he said, I'm going in. Anybody that wishes to follow me may do so. Bernardo de Galvez, with one little ship behind him and two launches, sailed into Pensacola Harbor with the British bombarding him, and he sailed in alone. Bernardo de Galvez put his troops ashore on Santa Rosa Island, and then little by little they began moving up toward the fort, the British fort at Pensacola. It took him three months of little by little moving in closer and closer, and finally he was able to put a hot shot into the powder magazine at Fort George. And it blew sky high. And the British surrendered. Now, why does that matter? 2 months later, George Washington was facing the British at Yorktown. If Bernardo de Galvez had not defeated the British at Natchez, at Baton Rouge, at Mobile, at Pensacola, those troops would have been able to march against Washington from the south and catch Washington in a pincer movement that would have destroyed any hopes for the American Revolution. Bernardo de Galvez saved the American Revolution. To this day, the city of Malaga has a cathedral with only one bell tower. That other bell tower was never built because of the money the people of Malaga sent to Bernardo de Galvez and the American Revolution. So, my Granaderos de Galvez over here, this group back here in the back, are determined to hang that portrait of Bernardo de Galvez in the halls of Congress. Not only that, but the members of the Sons of the American Revolution are planning to build an equestrian statue of Bernardo de Galvez for Galveston, which has no statues of their namesake. And in addition, there is a bill in Congress right now to make Bernardo de Galvez only the 7th honorary citizen of the United States of America, only the 7th in over 200 years. We don't know whether it'll happen. We don't know whether the curator of the halls of Congress is going to allow us to hang the portrait. But this is something that, if you are interested in participating, I am collecting emails, and I will be happy to send out. We're going to start a petition. We will send petitions to our congressmen, to our senators. At this point, there is a young woman, Teresa Valcarce, in Washington, D.C., who is working on getting that portrait approved. Senator Menendez has agreed to do it, and so we're hoping that by September, we will actually be able to hang the portrait, as was promised 230 years ago. So. So that goes to show you, you get these things and you just get swept up in them, and so now suddenly I'm going to Washington, D.C. and giving presentations. Yes?
Hispanic Forum is expanding the outside. We've been, as a matter of fact, we had the career day for the Hispanic Forum, and every year for the last, you know, as many years they've been running, we've been around for 30-something. Bernardo Galvez had in the story of the Texas connection, the American Revolution, that Robert Thornhall wrote about 30 years ago. You know, we've always talked about it. One thing, the other thing I found out here a few weeks ago, you go online and search Bernardo Galvez, there is a 30-minute presentation that he gives about the attack and all. And, you know, just talks about, you know, his thoughts basically, he's talking like he's Bernardo Galvez, and just gives a 30-minute, one-man show, basically, upon the life of what he did. But thank you. I hope this continues.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, Bob Tonhoff has been one of the cheerleaders since the beginning on this project. And so I think this is something to CARA, the Texas Connection of the American Revolution.
Yeah, I found out that there was a manual quote as one of the vaqueros that wrote cattle to Bernardo.
Absolutely.
From Texas.
Absolutely.
The cattle drive out of Texas was during the American Revolution.
For Bernardo de Galvez. Absolutely. Yes, and so this is, again, something that we need to develop as part of our Texas history. So thank you, my granaderos. This is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Okay, so here we are, back again. We'll move up a few decades, and we'll move up to the period of San Jacinto. And I think one of the difficulties when we look at Mexican history is to understand the conflicts that the families that were living here, and certainly the Hispanic Genealogical Society, those of us that are, you know, longtime Texans, my family were Tejanos way back when, but what was difficult for them was all the changes that were going on. This was a terribly difficult time for everybody. It wasn't easy. And so when we look at the De Leon family, this is a topic that I have dealt with for about 20 years now. I started off doing this as part of my dissertation. I finished my book on De Leon. And I do have copies available, but I would like to read you just the introduction. And sometimes I choke up, so forgive me. If Patricia de la Garza de León, wife of Martin de León, the founder of Victoria, Texas, were to return to her community 150 years after her passing, she would be amazed by the changes, but pleased with how much remains the same. The buildings on the main plaza of Victoria are different now, but she would be proud of the beautiful St. Mary's Church built on land she donated. She would be gratified to find that her husband, Martin de Leon, is well revered among the citizens of the city of Victoria. The descendants of their old friends among the early Tejanos, as well as the Anglo-Americans and the newer Mexican-American arrivals. Never a woman to flaunt her position, she would probably smile at seeing their names so prominently displayed on the plaques in the plaza. She could walk down the street of the 10 friends and remember those early settlers, her Irish friends, John Lynn and his family, and that old reprobate, Leonardo Manso. The rough bark of the now giant oaks in the plaza would recall the memories of Martin laying out the dusty streets, of building their home on the town square, or of the little tortilla store on the corner, of Placido Benavides's roundhouse, that Spanish torreón which provided refuge from the Indians. She would probably laugh at the memory of the city fathers struggling to build wooden fences around the plaza to keep the livestock and to protect the town well that Martin had built at such cost. But the changes would not frighten her. Her family dared the wilds of Nuevo Santander and helped found Soto La Marina. Fear had not slowed Doña Patricia and her beloved husband Martin when they crossed the Rio Bravo del Norte back in 1801 and settled next to the Apaches on the Nueces River with the first of their three children, nor when they dealt with Indians or Spaniards, or Anglo-Americans, nor did she fear when they moved with all 10 children to the crossing on the Guadalupe to found Victoria in 1824. She had faced danger time and time again. In 1814, from the dreaded General Arredondo during the Wars for Independence. In 1817, from the Anglo filibusters and the Comanche and Norteño raids. In 1836, from the wild and uncontrollable Texian troops. No, fear had never stopped her. Doña Patricia would ask, of course, after her family and the families of her friends, how did the marriage between her eldest son, Fernando, and Luis Escalera work out? Did they do well? She had always worried about Fernando. Had the inheritance she left young Francisco Santiago, her orphaned grandson, help him? And what about her daughters, Maria Jesus and Francisca? Had they lived comfortably from the mortgages that she gave them? And had all of Felix's children kept the Mission Valley Ranch? Felix had been so distraught over his son, Silvestre's drinking. Had Silvestre continued to drink? And dear Matiana, what a pair she and Luz Escalera had been, such businesswomen. Are their descendants still here? Yes, Doña Patricia, they are still here, the descendants of so many of the first families, the De Leones, the Benavides, De La Garzas, Carvajal, Barrera, Garcia, Leal, Moya, and so many new ones added every generation. They are all still here. What happened to the land, she would ask. It is gone. Doña Patricia, some stolen, some was sold, and the rest was divided among the children and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren until there was little left. There are still a few who keep the land. You remember the Perez family that moved here from San Antonio in 1834? They still have land around Bloomington, and they will only sell to Mexicanos. And old Carlos de la Garza, down on the San Antonio, he tried so hard to keep the land together. But it is almost gone now. Only the cemeteries remain. She would shake her head, sadly perhaps, but it would not surprise her. She and Don Martin had given up two ranches, one on the Nueces and one on the Aransas, when they moved to Victoria. She, too, had sold ranch lands to survive when they fled into exile in Louisiana in 1836. But when they returned, and they always returned, she did not let her family give up without a fight. She had encouraged Fernando and Candelaria and the family to fight the court battles to regain their land, and they won. In many of the cases, they regained the land they had lost. But when the land was divided among the grandchildren, better that all should have their tierra, their land, their herencia, an inheritance, no matter how small, than that some should be left with nothing. Yes, her family had suffered, but they had survived. Some had succeeded and prospered. Others had failed and died in poverty. But on the whole, as she looked around her community, Patricia de la Garza de León would be pleased. That's the story that I wanted to share with you today, the story of the de León family, the story of the problems that they faced during this tremendously challenging time. We have to look at the history of Mexico. Now, this is something that I didn't include last time, so I always have to give you all a little bit something new. But we have to understand what was going on in Mexico in 1800. At a time, as I said, when Patricia de la Garza and Martin came to the Aransas River, The French Revolution was now a thing of the past, and Napoleon had taken control of France, and Napoleon was invading Spain. During this time, the people of Spain had to decide whether they would side with Napoleon or whether they would join the rebel forces down in Seville, in Sevilla. What would you have done? This is the critical period for people in Spain. Now, in the north, in Texas, I was doing a presentation one time, and one of the gentlemen from, a historian from northern Mexico, was talking about the taxes. And it turns out that every state of Mexico would tax goods as they came north. The people in Nuevo Santander, in Tamaulipas, in Texas, were having to pay 10 times what people in Mexico City might pay. Angry, resentful, and New Orleans was right across the river where they could trade illegally. Is it any wonder that some of those settlers were running contraband? It was constant. As one of these historians said, nacieron encabronados in the north. They were born, well, to be polite, angry. That's probably as close as we can get at this point. The people in Texas were furious at having to pay these taxes, and so, yes, many of the citizens of Texas would trade. And why? Because they knew that they could take cattle to New Orleans. They had done it for Bernardo de Galvez. And so they knew the route, and they knew they could trade for goods. In addition, in 1805, the Spanish crown, desperate under Ferdinand VII to make more money, to get money to pay for the wars with Napoleon, called in all of the mortgages that were held by the Catholic Church. Can you imagine suddenly having to pay off your mortgage, all of it, right now? Again, the people in the north were not happy about this situation. Now, Martin de Leon, who happens to be the center of our story at this point, was born in 1765 in Burgos, a small town in the right at the edge of the mountains of Tamaulipas, and he was a muleteer. During this period, remember that 80% of all trade was carried by mules to and from the northern sections of the of Texas. As a muleteer, remember, he had to defend his cargo, because what did, as he was going through the mountains, all of the little Indian tribes took one look at those mules and they said, oh, goody, Walmart on hoofs. Is it any surprise that the Indians were willing to attack? So muleteers had to learn to defend their goods, defend their men, defend their money. Because remember, a muleteer was entrusted with goods. If he didn't buy it, people gave him the goods and said, you can pay me when you come back. So muleteers were people of tremendous honesty. They had to be. By the time he had done his stint as a muleteer, we're not sure whether he met Patricia de la Garza in the town of Soto la Marina. Soto la Marina during this time was one of the only ports other than Veracruz that could bring in cargo. However, the merchants of Mexico City, jealous of having someone else making money, closed down the port at Soto La Marina. And in this case, Patricia de la Garza's family, we know, had to have been very well-to-do. When I was studying the dowries for Monterey, for the city of Monterey, dowries in excess of $5,000 were unheard of. 5,000 pesos was an amazing amount. Patricia de la Garza had a dowry of 9,000 pesos. So she was of good family. Now, the big debate about Martin is, where did he rank on the social ladder? This, in Mexico, makes a huge difference. If you were Spanish, you were at the top. Only people who were Spanish could rise higher than the position of captain. Below them were what we call the criollos, the criollos. And a criollo was somebody who was of Spanish blood, but was born in the New World. But because you were born in the New World, that made you a little suspect. You were not as loyal to the king. And so certainly, somebody like Martin de Leon, who was a captain of the militia, was probably a Creole. We don't know. Patricia de la Garza, almost without a doubt, was a Spaniard. Oh my God, it's sort of like having your daughter marry a truck driver. Embarrassing. But Patricia de la Garza gave her husband the dowry, and with that dowry, they moved across the river and established their ranch. Does this have a little pointer? Look at that, how cute. Okay, so they came, here is Soto La Marina, way down here, and Burgos is just up. I'd go over there and point, but I'm not supposed to leave the podium here. Burgos is right up in the mountains, and then they came across the river and founded. Wait a minute, I gotta go look over here a little closer. Okay, here's Reynosa, Camargo, Mier, Guerrero, all of the towns of Nuevo Santander. They came across, and then up on the Nueces, they founded their first ranch. This was at a place that was called the Crossing for La Bahia. So this was an area that you're going to see a lot of traffic coming and going. So from Burgos, from Soto La Marina, they're going to move north, cross the river, and establish their ranch. Now, everybody knows the 16th of September, Mexican Independence Day, right? Wrong? No. It was an attempt at Mexican independence. This was Father Miguel Hidalgo y Costilla, who declares independence, or tries to separate from Spain. Successful? They caught him in Chihuahua City. They defrocked him. We have to mention that because he was a priest. They defrocked him, chopped his head off, sent his head back to Guanajuato, put it up on a stake, and the crows picked all the meat off the skull until there was nothing but the little bone rattling around on top of the spike. Father Miguel Hidalgo y Costilla started a movement, but the conservatives of Mexico want to remain with Spain. This, ladies and gentlemen, is where you have the beginning of the two separate beliefs of the Spanish. You have the Federalists. Now, this term Federalist is different than the American term Federalist. But in this case, we equate the Federalists with the liberals. It is usually going to be the people who are the middle classes, the educated, usually the poor, and that group, led by Miguel Hidalgo, are going to be opposed to the people who we call centralists. The term federalist here is a term that means someone who believes in a confederation of states, just like the American Civil War, just like the American Articles of Confederation. Same thing. So in this case, the Federalists, Confederation, believe in states' rights. They believe that Texas has the right to sell its own land. They believe that all of these separate states have the right to choose what they want to do. The Centralists, however, believe in a central government in Mexico City. And they believe in rule by the Spaniards. Not the Creoles, not the Mestizos, not the Indians, Spaniards. So in this case, Ferdinand VII in 1820, basically in Spain, crushes the liberal revolution. And when Fernando VII crushed the liberal revolution, if you are a conservative centralist in Mexico, you've suddenly got, oh my God, a liberal constitution that is going to be put back into place by rebels in Spain. Yes, Ferdinand tries to crush the constitution. Does it do him any good? No. That liberal constitution is forced on Fernando VII, and when that liberal constitution is in place in Spain, you all, my centralists in Mexico, are going to have a fit. You are suddenly going to decide, we don't want to have a liberal constitution. And so sure enough, it is the centralists who separate from Spain, not the federalists. So it was not Father Hidalgo who separated from Spain, but it was people that were very conservative and very centralists. When they separated from Spain, they took out Juan O'Donoghue, the last viceroy. But did they ask for a president? Who is it that is separating? It is the centralists. It is the conservatives. It is Spaniards. And what do they want? They want an emperor. They want an emperor. They want somebody who will be the kind of emperor that Ferdinand VII had not been. And so in this case, Agustin de Iturbide, from 1821 to 1824, tries desperately to put Mexico back on an even keel. The only difficulty is that those Spaniards suddenly decided that Mexico was not a good investment. Mine owners took their money and went back to Spain. Investors, Spanish businessmen who controlled the merchants, took their money and went back to Spain. And Mexico is suddenly left scrambling to try to keep the mines going and failing. Agustin de Iturbide is ousted. What flag flew over the Alamo? The flag of 1824, the Constitution, the liberal Constitution that replaces Agustin de Iturbide. Now, it is during this time, beginning with Iturbide, actually it was Iturbide who began the first settlements, and so he is the one who wants to copy the United States. If the United States can bring in settlers from all over the world, why shouldn't Mexico? Of course they can. But there is a difference. In the United States, you buy land. Under Spain, the king is your father, and the king gives the land. You don't sell land to your settlers. You give the land to your settlers so that they can then produce goods, and then you can tax the goods. That's okay. But give them the land. And we all know that you had to have an allegiance to Mexico, you had to swear to support the Catholic religion, and you had to be of good character. One of the things, public history, I took my students up to Rusk one time, and we did a reenactment. And I had one of my students dressed as a general in his military uniform. I had another one that was dressed as a priest. And we actually got the documents from the General Land Office. And we had all the little children that came to Rusk, to the festival. We had them raise their little hands and swear allegiance to Mexico. And they had to put their hand on the Bible and say that they were good Catholics and that they were of good character. And then we had them sign. We actually had dip quill pens, and we had them sign the documents. And then we would give them, roll the document up, and, you know, tie it with a red ribbon and put a seal on it with wax and gave it to the kids. And one little kid turns to his mother and he says, "Does that mean I'm a Mexican now?" And we said, "Sure, of course you are." But how much land was being given? Everybody knows, a league and a labor, right? 4,428 acres, plus your labor, 177 acres. For almost 5,000 acres, is it any wonder that suddenly 30,000 Anglos are coming across the border and swearing allegiance to Mexico, and they are good Catholics? 30,000 strong, not surprising. This was a great deal. This was a wonderful thing. Martin and Patricia de Leon had a whole slew bunch of kids. Martin de Leon says, if the incoming Anglos, like Stephen Austin, can get an impresario grant, what about me? I can get one. So sure enough, in 1824, Martin de Leon asks for an impresario settlement. Notice Fernando is born in 1798, Maria Candelaria in 1800, Jose Silvestre. These were the first three children that they had when they came to the ranch on the Aransas River. Lupita, Jose Felix, Agapito. Now, Agapito was actually killed fairly early, so we don't have any descent from him. Maria de Jesus Chucha, Refugia, Agustina, and Francisca. So the time that we are looking at then is all 10 of the children need land grants. And if all 10 of the children need land grants, hey, let's get an impresario grant. Now, what was an impresario? This is one of the things that we tend to forget. An impresario is a land agent. Does he actually get all the land? No, it's not given to him. Because the Spanish don't give the land to the impresario. It is the impresario's duty as a real estate agent to give land to his colonists. So an impresario has to, number one, bring in the settlers. Number two, make sure that they are good, legal, honest, upstanding citizens. And invariably, many of them weren't. He has to play judge. So when somebody gets mad at somebody else and shoots them, it is the impresario who has to solve the problem. He also has to survey or make sure that the land is surveyed. He has to write out the documents and send them to Mexico City in triplicate before they had Xerox machines. An impresario does everything. And what does he get for it? He gets 11 leagues. That was it. That was what you get. But you can't sell the land. No, because you're giving the rest of the land away. So incoming colonists aren't going to buy your land? No, you have to give them land for free. Stephen F. Austin was just scratching his head. He said, "Are these people nuts?" He begged the Spanish government to let him sell the land. And they said, nope, you give it away. Why? When Stephen F. Austin died, he died in poverty. Land rich, he had thousands and thousands of acres, none of which he could sell. Stephen F. Austin never did make any money. So Martin de Leon requests an impresario settlement, and sure enough, he gets this little teeny tiny section right there from Victoria, the Victoria Colony. It started off with 46 settlers, including, of course, his 10 children. And by this time, his children are now beginning to marry. The reason I have these in different colors is because Fernando, who actually, his wife was the first death in the colony in 1825, Maria Candelaria marries Jose Miguel Aldrete from Goliad. As a matter of fact, I was in Goliad a while back, and I met a family called the Alderites. And I said, the what? The Alderites. Aldretes. Today they call themselves Alderites. But the important thing is that those first three are going to be the leaders of the colony. The second group, Desiderio Garcia, Jose Felix, Agapito, and Manchola, are all going to be people who are going to settle in Goliad. Some of them remain. Jose Felix is going to remain in Mission Valley. Agapito is going to eventually be killed. And then the last two, Jose Maria Jesus Carbajal and Placido Benavides, these two are fascinating men. Jose Maria Jesus Carbajal was actually a resident of San Antonio. His mother had met Stephen F. Austin, and Stephen F. Austin sent Carbajal to Kentucky as an apprentice. He became interested in the Protestant religion. He came back as a card-carrying Baptist. Oh my God. And marries the next to the youngest daughter, sorry, third youngest daughter of Martin de Leon, as a surveyor. He becomes a surveyor for the Victoria Colony. Placido Benavides and his three brothers come over from San Antonio when San Antonio goes through the yellow fever epidemic, and Placido becomes the teacher. And this is one of those oopses, the teacher marries one of his students, Agustina. Francisca, notice that she does not marry until 1849. Why? As the youngest daughter, what is her duty? To take care of her parents. So she does not marry until after the death of her father. Now, remember when I read you that little section, poor old Fernando, he's the eldest. As the son of Martin, he should have been somebody who was able to deal politically with everybody. No. He went up to the DeWitt colony and got crossways with them over a donkey. They threw him in jail. He finally got out, goes back, and they capture a load of tobacco, which, under the Spanish rules, had to be taxed and could only be sold in specific stores. Once again, Fernando is thrown in jail. The donkey had been sold to Austin, but it had been left. And Martin de Leon had allowed the donkey to graze. And so when Austin came for the donkey, he was told, Austin was told, you're going to have to pay more money because the donkey's been eating all this time. Austin said, no, I won't. Fernando takes a load of corn up to the Austin colony, and Austin throws him in jail until he gets his donkey back. Fernando spent most of his time in jail. He was the land commissioner. What does a land commissioner do? He has to actually hand out the land. He has to give the land to the settlers. He has to take the settlers out, show them the land, let them choose what land they want. Plácido Benavides, as the teacher, is later going to go on to become the alcalde. And in 1831, Carbajal, as a surveyor, is going to be thrown in jail because he is giving lands, authorizing land sales to people in Anahuac, right in this area. So in this case, Carbajal is going to get into trouble. But he does manage to make it back and marries Refugia, and Benavides marries Agustina. Unhappily, in 1834, there is a cholera epidemic, and Martin de Leon dies. His family now has to decide what they're going to do. Because remember, what else happens in 1834? Santa Anna changes the government. That Constitution of 1824, the liberal Constitution of 1824, now I'm not going to go through all of Santa Anna's various switches back and forth, because remember, he was a liberal and then he was a conservative, and then he was a liberal and then he was a conservative. So in this case, by 1834, the conservatives have called on Santa Anna and said, please save us, we need a conservative government. In 1834, Santa Anna establishes the Siete Partidas, the Constitution of Seven Parts. That Constitution takes away the right of the states to sell their own land. The Federalist liberals are going to be up in arms. And with Martin de Leon gone, what are the boys going to do? Fernando is going to side with the Anglos, even though they'd thrown him in jail so many times. Aldrete is going to side with the Anglos, the Alderites. José Silvestre is going to side with the Anglos. Garcia, however, is going to side with Santa Anna. Felix is going to side with Santa Anna. Agapito is dead, but Rafael Manchola is also going to side with Santa Anna. Carbajal, because he speaks English and because he is Americanized, is going to side with the Americans. Plácido Benavides, too, is going to side with the Americans. You can imagine what Christmas dinner in 1834 must have been like at the De Leon household. Not a pleasant thing. During this period, Carbajal, because he is siding with those who oppose Santa Anna, is going to go to Monclova and join the Congress. Benavides is going to join Seguin at Santa Anna and fight against Santa Anna in 1835, in December. He is going to help to defeat General Cos in December of 1835. But by January 1836, with General Cos defeated, Santa Anna is not happy. Do the people in Texas know what Santa Anna did to Zacatecas when Zacatecas opposed him? You bet they do. Why do you think the runaway scrape happened? because they knew what Santa Anna would do to a populace. Fernando and Jose Maria Jesus Carbajal decide that they are going to sell horses in New Orleans to get money and supplies for the Texian troops. Unhappily, on their way back with all of those supplies, their ship is captured. The Hannah Elizabeth is taken by Santa Anna's forces. Fernando and Jose Maria Jesus Carbajal are thrown in jail in Matamoros. Placido Benavides leads a troop into Matamoros and saves his two brothers-in-law. General Urrea, by this time, is now moving up the coast, and certainly General Urrea is going to succeed at Goliad. He is going to capture Fannin, and certainly Carlos Ranch, right in here, Carlos de la Garza is going to side with Santa Anna. And he provided a spy group very much that was able to provide information to General Urrea. And certainly, Santa Anna made a huge mistake by sending his best troops against the Alamo. He could just as easily have gone around the Alamo, ignored it. It was a handful of men. He did not need to send his best troops and massacre so many of his own men in the battle at the Alamo. But because he did, Santa Anna then marches toward San Jacinto. Benavides, meanwhile, is in Matamoros, and Fernando is now back in Victoria, and he actually saves the John Lynn family. General Urrea, when he arrives in Victoria and finds out, throws Fernando back in jail. He spends most of his time in jail. Benavides, for those of you that are familiar with the Goliad reenactment, Hamilton, of course, is one of the men who turns against the Mexicans because of Plácido Benavides. Put yourself in Plácido Benavides's place. You have just found an American shot and wounded, dragging himself across the countryside, an escapee from Goliad. You put him in your wagon, and you start out across the countryside, and suddenly Mexican troops surround you. What would you do? You, with an American in your wagon, do you fight the Mexicans? There's too many of them. Benavides turned Hamilton over to the Mexican troops. Hamilton survived, not well, and he hated Benavides the rest of his life. So, who would you fight for? Who are you going to support? Are you going to support Mexico? Or are you going to support this strange new republic? There is another alternative. Stay the heck out of the way and stay on your ranch and keep your mouth shut. Many of the families did that. I know mine did. Sorry. The Castillos actually had a ranch in Refugio at this time. They stayed on their ranch and stayed out of trouble. What would you have done? Do you fight at San Jacinto? Seguin did. Many of the Tejanos did. Plácido Benavides did. What would you have done? Who do you fight for? San Jacinto was a dividing line for many of the Mexican families. For the De Leon family in particular, they faced a terrible dilemma. Who do you fight for? Or do you stay out of it completely? Many of the Tejanos fought with the Texans at San Jacinto. The De Leon family had to decide, would they be loyal to the new government? When General Rusk arrives in Victoria, he throws Fernando back in jail. And finally, the De Leon family left for New Orleans. Did they stay in New Orleans? No, they did not. Eventually, they did come back. And yes, Patricia de la Garza encouraged her daughters and her sons to fight for their land. So today, there are De Leon descendants in Victoria, Texas. Thank you. Thank you. Good. We've covered it all. Covered it all.
So much, and you put
Wait. We do have a question. Yes.
I'm just curious where the portrait is to be painted.
Oh.
Or is it yet to be painted?
Oh, no. It's a beautiful portrait by Goya. I don't know if I may have a Bernardo de Galvez
on your stick.
On my stick, yeah. See if I have one on Bernardo de Galvez. Actually, I had spoken to Manuel Olmedo Checa, and I went back to Malaga, and he said, I have a surprise for you. And he took me to a palace right across from the cathedral at Malaga, took me upstairs in this beautiful 16th, 17th century palace, and we walked into the living room, and there hanging on the wall for the last 200 years was that portrait of Bernardo de Galvez. I can tell you, I cried. It was so emotional.
Who is the painter?
We think it was Goya. We think it's one of Goya's very, very earliest paintings. Yes?
In Congress, did I have a portrait of Lafitte?
I don't know. I think they do. Therefore, there's no reason why not, yeah. Let's see. Yes, click on Bernardo portrait.
There's a Word document in there, it's old thing.
Okay, no, go down to the PowerPoints. PowerPoints, all the way down, the PowerPoints are all the way at the bottom. Okay, let's see. Books.
Short, short.
Yes. Yes, that one. There it is. That's the portrait. And actually, this is his shield, and this shield, because of his willingness to go into Pensacola alone, his shield has the little ship, and on the banner it says, I alone, yo solo.
That's by Goya. That's got to be worth an awful lot of money. Who's going to pay for it?
Well, they're making a copy. And so they're going to do a copy. We don't know for sure that it was Goya, but Goya was just getting started in the court of Charles III when this portrait would have been painted. And the beauty of the portrait, it's almost certainly a Goya, because he had such, you know, incredible skill. And the other portraits that you see of Bernardo de Galvez are not anywhere near this beautiful. So, yeah, it was impressive. It was impressive.
Is there any way to tell how many Tejanos fought on the side of Texas?
I'm sure some of our... I'm not sure. I don't know. There were a number in... More. Yeah. There was probably our genealogical experts can give us a better idea. Do we have any idea how many? Do we know how many?
Well, in Eden's company, there were, 30 plus, which would have represented several families. And in San Antonio, I don't know, there were quite a few.
Yeah.
Andres Tierrina told us one time in Austin about how many there were, but I don't remember.
Yeah, I know that there were many, but I don't know how many. Yeah, either Steve Harden or Andres Tijerina or Frank doesn't do San Jacinto much, but Menchaca was one of them. Certainly a lot of the what?
De Zavala.
De Zavala was there, Lorenzo. Yeah, there were a lot of them, but I don't know. And you can see why. You know, most of them would have said, thank you, but no thank you, I'll stay on my ranch. I know the Castillos did. So, but it depended on you know, whether you believed in this new republic or whether you hated Santa Ana bad enough to do something about it.
I imagine a lot of Anglos would have stayed on their ranches too.
Oh, you bet. You bet.
Stayed back and with too.
Paul Lack has written one of his books on the Texas Revolution. He says that 90% of the military, of Sam Houston's military, was from out of the state of Texas.
Yeah, they all came from Kentucky.
Yeah, yeah, Kentucky, Tennessee, Kentucky, yeah. Louisiana, the Louisiana Grays. Yeah, and it was because they were offered land. If you came and fought, you could have land. The people that were here already had land. What they feared was losing their land. So if they fought, they knew they would lose their land. So most of them did not fight. Yes?
A lot of people in the American Revolution didn't fight.
Absolutely. Yeah. A third supported the British, a third supported the Americans, and a third stayed the heck out of it. Didn't want to have anything to do with it. Yes?
The good crew over here at Lynchburg, who were considered Tories.
Absolutely.
Depending on which side of the water you work on.
Well, that's the thing. It any kind of war, there is always going to be differences of opinion. Yes.
What were the Indians up to at this time? Because I know my great-great-grandfather, after it was won, did not move his family out. Austin wanted him to come out to where they were because of the Indian problem, and he didn't.
The British had very close ties to the Choctaw, the Chickasaw, the Cherokee. So most of the tribes in the southeastern section of the United States were pro-British. And so being pro-British, you know, once the American Revolution was over, then most of those Indians had to make the decision also. You know, do you side with the Spanish? Do you side with... the Americans, what do you do?
We were busy in Texas with the Comanches and the...
Yes.
Iowa.
Apache, right. Apaches. Right, yeah. And that was, again, the Apache, remember, had been much the strongest until about 1832, 34, and then the Spanish changed and started supporting the Comanche instead of the Apache because the Comanche were stronger. And so that was a problem, you know, for the settlers. But the settlers just kept moving out into Indian territory, and the Indians kept saying, you know, stay out of our territory, and people didn't. So, yes?
You mentioned San Jacinto. Harrisburg, Texas. Was that already in existence when the battle took place?
I think it
was.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a settlement. It was a small settlement. It wasn't called Houston. It was. Yes, Harrisburg. Yeah, yeah, it was an Anahuac, because remember, Anahuac was here. Anahuac, Tenochtitlan, there was a series of forts around the outside edges of the colonies to try to protect the colonies, Austin's colonies. And, you know, the others, impresario grants. And so there were settlements or forts that were established all around. There were six forts that were established. Anahuac was one, Tenochtitlan. I don't know what they call it nowadays. It has some funny name in English. I don't know what it is. Like, I don't know how you would. Yeah, I don't remember. But it's some funny translation of, it's sort of like when I was doing studies in the American early colonial records, I found Warloope, and I looked at it and I said, Warloope? Guadalupe. It was the Warloope River. So you never know how they're going to write it out.
Harrisburg, Texas, you only wanted an English name?
No. Oh, sure. Well, San Felipe, of course, was Austin's settlement, but Washington on the Brazos was certainly Anglo names. And Belleville was an Anglo name. Certainly that was established early on. Most of the little settlements, Columbia was, all of the Anglo settlements all were named in English. And there was lots of them, 30,000 strong. So yeah, there were a lot of them.
So yeah. Martin was 30 years older than his wife?
Yes.
Was it Patricia?
Patricia de la Garza.
So you mentioned the year when, and then they had all those children, and then you mentioned the year when he died. But when did she find him?
She didn't die until 1854.
So she lived a long time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but
10 kids.
30-year difference in their marriage, and they had this.
He must have been good-looking son of a gun, because in his uniform, whatever. Yes, Loretta.
Could you tell us when your family came to Texas and what they were doing?
My family, embarrassingly enough, this is one of those problems with genealogy. You never, ever want to look up genealogy if you can avoid it. I was in Mexico City, and I was doing research on Stephen F. Austin, and I ran across Jose Maria Castillo in 1792, who went AWOL from his unit in Monterey, and for punishment, they sent him to Goliad. Because they figured he was going to die. Yeah. They figured anybody that was sent to Goliad was probably not going to make it. Actually, he married one of the daughters of one of the other soldiers, and they set up a ranch in Refugio. And then they were there for about 100 years until 1870s. And then they got crossways with the welders. And there are still welders today in Refugio County. And there was a court case. And in the court case, the welders were given right to land that they had been running their cattle across, and it was Castillo land. And so Severo Castillo, one of the grandsons, shot Tom Welder, one of the other welder sons. And so Severo and Manuel had to make a run for the border to avoid being killed, hung. And as a matter of fact, it was your uncle, Benny Martinez, who was, that's right, your father, my gosh. See there? I was doing a presentation for the LULAC chapter here in Houston, and I told this story, and Benny said, I remember my grandmother telling me the story of these two young Mexicans that were running for the border, and we hid them on our ranch, she said. And I said, do you remember their names? And he said, yes, it was Severo and Manuel Castillo. And I said, Benny, if it hadn't have been for you, I wouldn't be here today. So there you go.
First Castillo gave a daughter to Tebow. It doesn't matter if he...
Oh, that's... Oh, well, that's through my mother. My mother's side is...
But even those Castillos, if they were here,
oh, that's true. They would have.
Tebow in 1783 with Carlos III issued the decree.
That's true. See there. I can be a granadero.
You can stay in my rancho anytime.
Thank you. That's good.
And please stay and visit. And you've got books?
I do. I have some.
If you,
I would be happy to.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for coming, and Dr. Grant, you are a treasure.
Thank you.